today.
Hi.
So let me know if you can't hear me. I'll try to be louder. I'm Jessica Mizzatoris. I work with Literary Arts, and thank you all for being here. We're excited to be partnering with PDX Jazz tonight and bring you this lecture. For those of you who are not familiar with Literary Arts, we're a nonprofit community-based arts organization with a 35-year history of serving readers and writers. Our mission is to engage readers, support writers, and to inspire the next generation with great literature. We're supported by community members just like you, so thank you all. Our programs include Portland's Arts and Lectures, programs for youth, the Oregon Book Awards, and fellowships. The awards happen on Monday. That was fun. We also offer Delve Reader seminars, writing classes, and host free literary arts events at our downtown center year-round. For any writers in the room, on Wednesday, May 1st, we will be hosting One Page Wednesday, where we invite you to share a page of your current project. So be here if you're interested, May 1st at 7 p.m. And you can find a full calendar of events on literaryarts.org. And now I'm going to hand it over to your wonderful host, Deborah DeMoss-Smith.
Thank you. I don't know about the wonderful part, but I am the host. First of all, thanks to Literary Arts. They're a dream to work with. They really care about the arts, and I appreciate that. Also, thanks to y'all for showing up tonight. Marcia Hocker is an adamant, award-winning aficionado of jazz, and her actions exemplify that. Number one, she's on the PDX Jazz Board of Directors. She's the chair of that organization's education committee. She's the coordinator of Incredible Journey of Jazz, which is a great program, an educational program that delivers the story of jazz to schools. She hosts a jazz radio show. We could be here all night. She's a vocalist who delivers jazz standards on the stage, though she's never asked me to join in with her. I don't understand that. Oh, I can't sing. Maybe that's it. And y'all can find her emceeing events in the metro and nationwide. She's the recipient of the Regional 2018 Jazz Journalists Association Award called the Jazz Hero Award. And tonight, she presents Discover Jazz, the Resilience of Jazz. Please welcome Marcia Hocker.
There I am. Am I on? Okay. Well, good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming this evening. There are a number of events that are taking place in this town, jazz events, and we thank you so much for choosing to spend your evening with us. Thank you. The soundtrack you heard is from a Freddie Hubbard album, 1974 release, entitled High Energy. The tune was inspired by a book, Black Power Beyond Borders. The composer of that melodious, haunting piece was Stevie Wonder. One of the giants in jazz was pianist, composer, arranger Mary Lou Williams, someone who thought of herself as a soul player who never strayed far from melody and blues. She would say, "I am praying through my fingers when I play to get that good soul sound and try to touch people's spirits." She caught the attention of the Vatican and was invited to compose a jazz mass. And after doing so, she remarked, quote, "Suffering was at the root of the music, and that jazz always had a spiritual side," unquote. She performed her highly regarded jazz spiritual at St. Patrick's Cathedral, marking the first time a jazz musician had played at the church. She also put a lot of effort into working with youth choirs to perform her works at St. Patrick's Cathedral before a gathering of over 3,000 people. She set up a charitable organization and opened thrift stores in Harlem, directing the proceeds along with 10% of her own earnings to musicians in need. Slavery existed in Africa before Europeans arrived. The enslaved, however, were not brutalized or dehumanized. They were respected, able to obtain freedom, and often held public office. When Africans sold other Africans to white people, they had no idea they were contributing to a far different system filled with brutality that would disrupt black progress for centuries to come. Those who survived the Middle Passage, having been separated from their mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers, were very brave people, important to our country and to the journey of jazz. The work they did on plantations made America rich financially, and the musical ideas they brought with them made American jazz rich in rhythm. Gospel music has long been a part of the African-American experience. Beginning in the fields with the work songs, the roots of this music came from the need to surmount intense oppression, to cope with unspeakable cruelties. For example, whites believed that they could take a 4 or 5 year old black child and place them at their feet when they were sick because they thought that the child had the properties of leech therapy. Their methods of shackles, branding, whipping, sexual assault, mutilations, amputations, and defecating in the mouths of slaves were all tactics used to instill fear for the sake of control. Worship, as you can imagine, became a respite, and when some slaves were eventually allowed to read, they learned that the Bible justification of slavery espoused by whites was inaccurate. The topic of slaves and masters in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 5 through 9 reads, "Slaves, Obey your earthly masters with respect and fear, and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them, not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but like slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly, as if you were serving the Lord, not men, because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does, whether he is slave or free. And masters, treat your slaves the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no favoritism in him. The lyrics of the gospel music, also known as Negro spirituals, have stood the test of time. They're simple, clear, and communicate the message of God's love and forgiveness expressed through the death and resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ. This message was embraced by many blacks, giving them strength to cope with their circumstances. It just so happens that the top-selling gospel album of all time is Aretha Franklin's Amazing Grace. And the documentary is now showing at selected theaters here in Portland. And by the way, Aretha Franklin was awarded the Pulitzer Prize a couple of weeks ago. It's the special citation for her indelible contribution to American music and culture for more than five decades. She is the first individual woman to receive a special citation prize, which was first awarded in 1930. Past winners have included John Coltrane.
Say some people long ago were looking for a different tune, one that they could croon as only they can. They only had the rhythm, so they started swaying to and fro. They didn't know just what to use, but this is how the blues really began. This is the way the blues began. They heard the breeze through the trees, singing weird melodies, and they named that just the start of the blues. Then from a jail there came a wail, from a down-hearted frail, and they played that as a part of the blues. From a whippoorwill sitting high on a hill, they took a new note and they pushed it through a horn until it was worn ahead to a blue note. And then they nursed it, yeah, rehearsed it, and then gave out the news that the Southland really gave birth to the blues.
That tells a story. And then we had the blues from the Delta. And it made your shoulders roll if you were sitting in your seat, because you just couldn't sit still. Mississippi Delta to Chicago to Harlem. A generation of people were moving from the countryside into the urban centers throughout the United States. People who left rural, repressive communities that held limited possibilities and limited promise. They traveled with as much of their past, good and horrible, and cultural traditions as they could mentally and physically carry. These helped to provide a solid base for uprooted families in a strange part of America that was often hostile.
I'm sorry that I didn't become the world's first black classic pianist. I think I would have been happier. I'm not very happy now. A scholarship of mine, and they didn't give me the opportunity to start as a black classical pianist. I was refused a scholarship because I was black.
Together, they gave us jazz, an American art form. With the elements of blues and gospel at its core, jazz was very appealing, and its popularity grew rapidly. Many people across the country wanted to hear it, yet one needed courage to take it on the road.
Patience and fortitude. Patience and fortitude, patience and fortitude, and things will come your way. When you have solitude, can make life dull and cruel. Patience and fortitude, and things will come your way. Couldn't wait for the egg to hatch, used to burn both ends of a match. Couldn't wait for the cake to bake, but now I can see it's a big mistake. Patience and fortitude, patience and fortitude, patience and fortitude, and things will come your way. River wears the rug, the rock, with patience, fortitude. Rust will spoil the strongest lock, with patience, fortitude. Hot as fire will soon grow cold. Patience, fortitude. Awful nanny will grow old. Have patience, fortitude.
Hallelujah.
Patience and fortitude. Patience and fortitude. Patience and fortitude. Then things will come your way. Hallelujah. Tracy will get a rest, have patience, 42. Pullman trains will soon have space, have patience, 42. Crosby's horse will win a race, have patience, 42.
No danger.
Patience and 42. Patience and 42. Patience and 42. And things will come your way. And things will come your way.
Patience and fortitude. 80 years ago, Victor Hugo Green, an African-American postal worker and a travel writer from Harlem, started producing the Negro Motorist Green Book to help black travelers find accommodations and services in segregated America. Mr. Green looked forward to the day when his book wouldn't need to be published. He said, quote, "It will be a great day for us to go as we please without embarrassment," unquote. This, however, was not to be. This is not the 1936 rendition. This is the 2017 edition of the Green Book, and it covers the years between 2013 and 2016. Of the indignities that black folks still go through while traveling across the United States. You should know that Portland was a part of the Green Book in that they provided accommodations to folks here, the musicians who came here from East Coast, and not long after George and I moved here to Portland, we had the pleasure of meeting Lawrence Edward Caldwell. In 1960, Ed became the first African-American graduate of Oregon State University's College of Pharmacy, where he earned a Bachelor's of Science and the coveted Kilmer Prize for research in pharmacognosy. His accomplishments and awards in pharmacy are many. And in 1971, Ed and his wife, Donna, also a pharmacist, opened Portland Center Pharmacy, downtown Portland. Their home, the Caldwell home, provided the lodging and meals for special guests coming here. One of them was Lionel Hampton. And it was in their home that the 1947 jazz standard, Midnight Sun, was composed.
Yeah. Wow.
Cool, huh?
Yeah.
Also, Portland historical jazz vocalist Nola Bogle met Don Shirley, for whom this year's Academy Award-winning movie was about, at a place called Joe's Le Bois in Boise, Idaho. But even when black artists were able to find safe harbors, there was no guarantee of civility. On April 10, 1956, Montgomery, Alabama native Nat King Cole, accompanied by Britain's greatest post-war big band, the Ted Heath Orchestra, was welcomed to the stage by Birmingham, Alabama Mayor Jimmy Morgan. They were on their third song when members of the KKK Confederacy rushed the stage. Cole was knocked down by a group of club-wielding white men. One of them grabbed the startled singer, wrestling him over the piano stool onto the floor. Some of the members in the audience thought that the people that were rushing to the stage were doing so because there was a man in the front row chanting, "Nigger, go home." So they thought that was happening until they went up on the stage. Interestingly, the group was organized by Asa Carter, who, as a speechwriter, would pen the George Wallace Segregation Forever speech. In addition to poisoning his dog after Cole moved to an affluent neighborhood in Los Angeles, the Ku Klux Klan responded by placing a burning cross on his front lawn. Members of the Property Owners Association told Cole, quote, "They did not want any undesirables moving into the area," unquote, to which Cole replied, famously, quote, "Neither do I. And if I see anybody undesirable coming in here, I'll be the first to complain."
What is it about the Negro? I mean, every other group that came as an immigrant somehow, not easily, but somehow got around it. Is it just the fact that Negroes are black?
White America must see that no other ethnic group has been a slave on American soil. That is one thing that other immigrant groups haven't had to face. The other thing is that the color became a stigma. American society made the Negro's color a stigma. America freed the slaves in 1863 through the Emancipation Proclamation of Abraham Lincoln, but gave the slaves no land, are nothing in reality, and as a matter of fact, to get started on. At the same time, America was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that there was a willingness to give the white peasants from Europe an economic base. And yet it refused to give its black peasants from Africa, who came here involuntarily in chains and had worked free for 244 years, any kind of economic base. And so emancipation for the Negro was really freedom to hunger. It was freedom to the winds and rains of heaven. It was freedom without food to eat or land to cultivate, and therefore it was freedom and famine at the same time. And when white Americans tell the Negro to lift himself by his own bootstraps, they don't look over the legacy of slavery and segregation. I believe we ought to do all we can and seek to lift ourselves by our own bootstraps. But it's a cruel jest to say to a bootless man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. And many Negroes, by the thousands and millions, have been left bootless as a result of all of these years of oppression and as a result of a society that deliberately made his color a stigma and something worthless and degrading.
In 1955, American racism was going strong and spread globally with the Soviet Union's pervasive propaganda about the United States and racism.
At this remarkable concert in Accra, West Africa, Louis Armstrong and his All-Stars play before a crowd of more than 100,000 people. This was Armstrong's first time in Africa, and he was amazed that his fame had spread so far and wide. The U.S. government took note. The global popularity of Armstrong and his peers got foreign policy officials thinking that jazz could give America an edge in the Cold War struggle for hearts and minds. However, there was one problem. This concert could not have taken place in Armstrong's hometown of New Orleans because racially integrated performances were banned, and the All-Stars included two white musicians. This is the story of when America asked its greatest jazz musicians to travel the globe as Cold War cultural ambassadors, and why they agreed to go.
The challenge for these iconic musicians was, how do they represent their country in the best light with honesty when there's so much unrest and injustice in America?
First superpower to put a satellite in orbit.
It's difficult to underestimate how spectacular the launch of Sputnik was as a propaganda achievement. For many people in the world, that single event established the Soviet Union not just as a political wave of the future, but as a scientific wave of the future.
Outraged by both Little Rock and Sputnik, Duke Ellington wrote an article titled The Race for Space, in which he argued that racism was losing America the Cold War.
Because so many Americans persist in the notion of the master race, millions of Negroes are deprived of proper schooling, denied the right to vote on who will spend their tax money, and are the last hired and first fired in those industries necessary for the progress of the country.
This was a very difficult moment for the government, but by this time, the State Department is so invested in the cultural programs, in jazz, as a way of saying, this is our distinct modernism, the Soviets can't compete with it, this is Black American music, our race relations are improving. So to have stopped the program would have really been to concede defeat to the Soviets.
Change. It always has to start with someone somewhere. And in this case, it was a New York congressman who played a key role in jazz going overseas.
We've just decided that we're going to shift the emphasis to our jazz, our Negro spirituals, and send these artists over where they can reach the masses of the people of Asian Africa. And one of the people who we're planning to use, my friend Dizzy Gillespie, who's the father of modern jazz. What do you think about that, Dizzy?
I don't think we have any trouble converting the people over to our style of music.
You think they'll dig that?
I think they'll dig it very nicely.
This will write my call a cool war, rather than a cold war.
Very good. The weapon that we will use is the cool one.
To have been chosen as the first jazz musician to represent the United States on a cultural mission. They had many people they could have chosen as the first one. And I sort of liked the idea of representing America, but I wasn't going over there to apologize for the racist policies of America.
they chose Dizzy because he was famous. He already had an international following. But what was not clear, I think, to the State Department, that Dizzy had a history of political activism. He was once a card-carrying member of the Communist Party, not so much because he believed in it, but because in the 1930s, you can get a gig at a CP event. Here's someone who was always very outspoken about civil rights and human rights. So he was the unlikely choice politically. He was a very likely choice in the commercial realm.
He was not going to sugarcoat some of the horror that was going on to black people at that time. He was not going to get America off the hook. And that's what he said. And we all basically felt the same way.
When the State Department suggested a pre-tour briefing, Dizzy gave them a little taste of what was to come.
I've got 300 years of briefing. I know what they've done to us, and I'm not going to make any excuses. If they ask me any questions, I'm going to answer them as honestly as I can.
When it came to musical preparations, Dizzy entrusted his orchestra to a rising young arranger, one Quincy Jones.
I was 22 years old, and Dizzy came to me and said, I would like you to be musical director, arranger, and trumpet player with the band. I was so happy. I was like in heaven, honey, to think he'd have to trust in me at 22 years old to be in charge of my God's band. We went, and it was the most incredible thing I've ever seen. We went to Iran, Karachi, Pakistan, Aleppo, Damascus.
People loved the music. They really loved it. It was so beautiful, man, to get that kind of response, man.
Those three clips are from the Jazz Ambassadors, a PBX production. It is a wonderful, educational, inspiring piece of our history. This photo I want to share with you because I've been asked, why were grown men wearing these big signs saying, I am a man? You know, you'll hear in black dialogue, you'll hear them say, hey man, how you doing man, what's up man? Yeah, oh man, that was good. It's because they were called boy all their lives. And that's why the expression man is a part of the dialogue. Classical music and indigenous art form. Chicago poet Haki Madhubuti, also known as Don Lee, says this about art. quote, "Art allows and encourages the love of self and others. Artists are in the beauty and creation business. Art is the waterfall of life, reflecting the untimely and unique soul of a people. Fundamentally, art inspires, informs, directs, generates hope, and challenges the receiver to respond," unquote. In 1817, when jazz was launched from Congo Square in New Orleans, dancing was a part of the festivities, as you have heard my dear friend Deborah tell you time and again. Yes. As jazz progressed, so did the dancing. Under the choreographer Herbert White, here are the dancers from Harlem who originated the Lindy Hop. They are called Whitey's Lindy Hoppers. Spirits. To this day, this art form continues to be celebrated, practiced, and performed worldwide, including Russia. Tap dancing is the jazz of dance and a part of America's social fabric. It originated as juba, J-U-B-A, a kind of dance practiced by African slaves. Savion Glover and the late Gregory Hines met with members of Congress to share its history on May 25th, and on May 25th, 1989, the 101st Congress passed a bill into law designating May 25th as National Tap Dance Day. And the reason why they chose May 25th is because it was Bill Bojangles' birthday. And like the Lindy Hop, tap dancing is practiced worldwide.
got a shoehorn?
Jazz, its inward significance reflects people who are undeniably relevant and resilient, able to survive and thrive against all odds. Many of the believers in Christ embrace this passage, which says, quote, "We are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed," unquote. That's 2 Corinthians 4, 8-9. April is Jazz Appreciation Month, fondly referred to as JAM, and we all know JAM is sweet. It was named so by the National Museum of American History at the Smithsonian back in 2002, and its purpose was to discuss and explore jazz in all aspects across this country. This year, JAM celebrates jazz beyond borders by looking at the dynamic ways jazz can unite people across the culture and geography. This theme is to celebrate the next tour of the Smithsonian Jazz Masterworks Orchestra, which will visit cities in North America, Europe, and Asia. This tour will ignite the Smithsonian's goal of convening conversations in which we will use the power of music as a springboard to important discussions around diversity, identity, diplomacy, and innovation. It just so happens that this year's feature artist is Nat King Cole, and his work as an innovative artist, a world influencer, and dynamic performer. He was international, and he gained wide support from around the globe. He pushed racial boundaries that sought to prevent him from success. He was the first African-American to host his own television series, The Nat King Cole Show. In 2011, April 30th was named International Jazz Day by UNESCO, the United Nations Education, Science, and Cultural Organization. Their efforts have grown its presence to being celebrated in over 190 countries on all seven continents. This year's global host is Melbourne, Australia. Last year it was St. Petersburg, Russia. The year before that, Havana, Cuba. And before that, America at the White House. You'll recognize this as the great day in Harlem.
Between the two people in front of you. There are two people in front of you, you're between them and not behind somebody. So I can get a chance to see everybody. I really want everybody's face in this picture.
So to sum up the relevance and resilience of jazz, its dignity and impact on humanity, I'll close with this message from a man who graduated high school at 15, received his bachelor's at 19, a master's at 22, and his doctorate at 26, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. He presented this opening address at the 1964 Jazz Festival in Berlin. Quote, God has wrought many things out of oppression. He has endowed his creatures with the capacity to create, and from this capacity has flowed the sweet songs of sorrow and joy that have allowed man to cope with his environment and many different situations. Jazz speaks for life. The blues tell the story of life's difficulties, and if you think for a moment, you will realize that they take the hardest realities of life and put them into music, only to come out with some new hope or sense of triumph. This is triumphant music. Modern jazz has continued in this tradition, singing the songs of a more complicated urban existence. When life itself offers no order and meaning, the musician creates an order and meaning from the sounds of the earth which flow through his instrument. It's no wonder that so much of the search for identity among American Negroes was championed by jazz musicians. Long before the modern essayists and scholars wrote of racial identity as a problem for a multicultural world, musicians were returning to their roots to affirm that which was stirring within their souls. Much of the power of our freedom movement in the United States has come from this music. It has strengthened us with its sweet rhythms when courage began to fail. It has calmed us with its rich harmonies when spirits were down. And now, jazz is exported to the world. For in the particular struggle of the Negro in America, there is something akin to the universal struggle of modern man. Everybody has the blues. Everybody longs for meaning. Everybody needs to love and be loved. Everybody needs to clap hands and be happy. Everybody longs for faith. In music, especially this broad category called jazz, there is a stepping stone towards all of these. Thank you so much for coming this evening.
I wasn't going to miss the ball. I didn't miss the ball.